Good morning to all attendees. I, Dr. Suman Vaishnav, would like to start the session for today. Today we have Dr. Sohail Khan from Griffith University with us. I'll just start with a small intro of Dr. Sohail Khan. Dr. Khan is a faculty in the School of Pharmacy and Pharmacology, Griffith University. Which is situated in Australia. He's also a research fellow at the Master Research Institute at the University of Queensland. He did his master's in clinical pharmacy and an MBA in healthcare services from Manipal, that is Manipal Academy of Higher Education. He was awarded the International Postgraduate Research Scholarship from Commonwealth Australia for his PhD. Regarding his research area, Dr. Khan research area spans across the public health priorities such as antimicrobial resistance, global health safety, and medication safety in context to evidence-based medicine. He has many awardees. He has been awarded many times. He has published various scientific papers. He has also chaired many sessions for international conferences based on clinical research, which were on clinical research. As an academician, Dr. Khan has developed number of programs in EBM, that is evidence-based medicine in Australia. And currently, he is the program director for PhD studies in pharmacy and pharmacology at Griffith University. I welcome you, Dr. Sohail Khan, on behalf of Chitkara University, Chitkara College of Pharmacy, Punjab. For this session, I guess we all are very enthusiastic in listening to you. I hand over the screen to you. You can proceed with the presentation, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Suman. A very good morning to one and all, my dear students, faculty. I would like to thank Dr. Suman Harleen Ma'am for organizing this webinar and also the leadership team at Chitkara University. I'm not sure whether you students remember, but I did attend one of your global week where foreign faculty are invited to deliver a seminar. I think I did it almost 2 years back. So I had a great time interacting with pharmacy and science students. So this is just an extension of strengthening our ongoing collaboration with Chitkara University and also to share on what are the research and clinical practice advancement that's ongoing in this part of the world and also discussing with you in regard to what are your thoughts, what are your plans in terms of your career development, higher studies and professional growth. The core of today's webinar, of course, is a timely topic that we all are dealing with. So definitely we are going to go through that in context to what you as students can do or could help. So we will do that at first part, and then second part will be on career development opportunities and question and answer session. I hope I'm audible and it's clear. And I hope you guys can put a question in the chat box as well. So maybe I think if any one of you can type in the chat box, I just want to see if you can do that, if you can type in chat box, because I want to make this session interactive as we go rather than having a question and answer at the end of the webinar. So if you have an option, I think there is a chat icon in the webinar where you can type. Okay, just chat, type hello or anything so that we can see who could do it.
Okay, any one of you just type out any question or any chat. I just, I guess we are getting the question, sir. Yeah, good morning, Twinkle, everyone. Good morning to all. So we are good to go.
Okay, all good to go.
Yeah.
Alright, so let's start with our core content on increasing value and reducing waste, which is kind of a dilemma. Okay, and why dilemma? I'll put it forth in our coming slides. So this is in context to clinical research. And every one of us, regardless of which discipline you are studying, are relevant. Okay, to clinical research and making a difference out there for better patient care. So what's happening in COVID-19 research is a lot of clinical and scientific evidence are being published on a daily basis. There is information explosion happening. And the tools to assess the credibility of that information is lagging behind, which is impacting the lives of the patient as well as making timely decision in regard to effective and safe therapies. That's where this topic is coming from. So it's highly relevant in one way or another. A presentation overview. We'll look into background in regard to COVID-19 origin, spread, and what's the epidemiology as of now. Then we will move into the current dilemma of evidence-based medicine being overtaken by hype-based medicine in post-COVID-19 era. I'll give you some critical appraisal tools, very important for we as future learners in evidence-based practice to be familiar with what are the critical appraisal tools to differentiate between real and rubbish evidence. Okay, and then the last part of this webinar will be a discussion on career development. Okay, what are your career goals? If you are thinking to pursue higher education abroad, what are the scholarship options and so on? Okay, and we will have a question and answer session as well. So this is the presentation overview. Let's start with the background. The current global pandemic, as we all know, originated as an unexplained respiratory tract infection in the Wuhan province of China last December. The causative or etiologic agent was a novel coronavirus by the name SARS-CoV-2, and the disease was abbreviated as COVID-19, which is coronavirus disease 2019, and the short form is COVID-19. COVID-19 infection has spread across the world with reported cases in over 150 countries, infecting millions of people worldwide. The median age affected by this disease ranged from 35 to 60 years. That's the most common age range, but it did affect pediatrics as well. The clinical symptoms, I'm sure you will be knowing, include fever, cough, fatigue. Cough is usually dry in nature, anorexia, myalgia, muscle pain, dyspnea, difficulty in breathing, anoxia and agesia, that is difficulty in smell and taste. So these symptoms then could progress to pneumonia and acute respiratory distress syndrome. The global mortality as of now has exceeded 6%, and it increases with age. Who are at high risk? The high risk groups are elderly over 60 years and people with comorbid condition, which include diabetes, chronic cardiovascular complication, renal or pulmonary disease. So with this overview in background, let's have a quick look on what are the therapies in COVID-19. Okay, before we move to pharmacotherapy or drug treatment in COVID-19, what are the treatment options as of now? So COVID-19 treatment is broadly divided into two common approach. One is home-based care and another is hospital care. Now, home-based care is appropriate for patient with mild infection who can be adequately isolated in outpatient setting. So for example, for this patient, the primary goal of care is to prevent transmission to others and to monitor for their clinical deterioration, if any. The other part is hospital care. So hospital care is predominantly supportive for severe and critically ill patient. Okay, so when a patient is COVID-19 positive, that doesn't mean that all of them need hospitalization. In fact, if you look into the epidemiological pattern, around 20 or less than 20% of COVID positive cases may need hospitalization. 80% of the cases could be self-managed at home. Okay, so for those 20% of the cases that needs hospitalization, the treatment as of now is symptomatic. Oxygen therapy represents the major intervention for patients with severe infection that includes mechanical ventilation, hemodynamic support, and then supportive care, which I will shortly share with in the form of pharmacotherapy. Now, given that majority of current treatment options are supportive in nature, public health measure has played a very crucial role in controlling the transmission in the community. So measures such as personal hygiene and public isolation are proving beneficial. So proactive isolation measures across various countries has led to a progressive reduction of cases. So we do have success stories. So for example, countries such as New Zealand and Australia, where we are based. So we have been able to flatten the curve, as they say. And I will share the success story on what different we did and what are the challenges, ongoing challenges across the globe. Okay, so before now, as I'm informed that all of you are from pharmacy background, so before we move further on pharmacotherapy in COVID-19, let's do a small activity. I will share a screen. I hope it works. So this is an online activity. So I will share a screen here. Okay, so if you guys can open the web link menti.com, www.menti.com, and I hope you can see this and use the code as given here, 202240, so you can participate in this online quiz. Okay, so go to www.menti.com and enter the code 202240 to participate. Guys are able to participate, so how shall I know? Can someone type in the chat box that yes, you can participate? Dr. Suman or Harleen, ma'am, can you participate in this?
Yes, I'll just check out whether they can participate or not.
Yeah.
Give me 2 minutes, I'll just check out the thing.
The participation, yes. So I can see the numbers here on my screen. So there are at present around 40 participants. So looks like there are many who are yet to participate. So yes, all of you, if you can please participate in this, because this will be our online activity. There will be question and answer session also, and we can have a discussion through this. Okay, so that in real time we would get to know any query from you guys. Okay, so please participate. Menti.com, use the code 202240. You can participate on your mobile or on the laptop. Okay, we'll give 2 more minutes and then we'll quickly start the discussion session. So just a background, we overviewed COVID-19, the causative agent, the spread, typical age range, risk factors, and then we'll look into the treatment approach, home-based care and hospital care, which type of patient need which approach, and next will be therapies. Okay, so what are the therapies available, and what are the safety and efficacy parameters. Yeah, 1 more minute and we will start the quiz. So I've done one question and answer. I've done a quiz session for you guys. So I just want to see the background again on a level of understanding, and then we will go ahead from there. Okay. I think we can start now. So, what are your expectations for this webinar? Okay, so what are your take-home message or what you want to achieve from this webinar? So I have given some options, so feel free to tick your expectations from the given options so that I know, and I'll tailor my session accordingly. So the options there are to update knowledge, to learn new skill, networking, be inspired, career development, higher studies, overseas. Okay, so the 5 top options that I usually pick for my students whenever we deliver a webinar. So I can't be there in person with you, so that's why we thought this is one of the best way to engage with our students and to know our audience. I can see we have 80 plus respondents now, approaching almost close to 90. Okay, I'll give 1 more minute and then we'll move to our core content. Okay, looks like we are almost hitting 100 now. So the top 2 expectation is to update knowledge. So yep, you are in the right webinar because there will be a lot of content, especially in regard to EBM, that I'll be sharing with you on what's happening in this current challenging global pandemic. And I will definitely share the career development opportunities as well as higher studies overseas. What are the options and how we are looking into the current challenge. Okay, 1 more. Okay, be ready. Which stream do you represent? So I want to know where you are coming from, which program you are enrolled. Are you from PharmD, B-Pharm, M-Pharm? I believe all are pharmacy group for today. So let's see how many of you are from these 3 different programs. So we are almost equal, I think PharmD and B-Pharm, and then we have M-Pharm and looks like MSc. Okay, one last before we move. Can you list 2 drugs or medication that you know are currently used in the management of COVID-19. Okay, just type it out in your response box. Okay, you can do 2 responses at a time. There is no right or wrong answer here. Nobody's judging. So I just want to know. Okay, Okay, so if you guys are familiar with the names of the drugs in the management of COVID-19. Looks like we definitely have one popular name that everyone is familiar. Now the name has gone beyond the pharmacy, pharmacology and medicine crowd, and it has gone into the villages. You know, which is hydroxychloroquine, most popular buzzword as of now. Great. I can see a lot of other responses also apart from chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine. You have remdesivir, yeah. Can see paracetamol, symptomatic relief, zinc, some of you responded, that's right, all symptomatic management. I can see antibiotics also, some has listed doxycycline. Antimalarial, yeah, vitamin C. So antimalarial, chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, antiviral, which is experimental, remdesivir, ritonavir, which is for HIV infection, so it's also being trialed currently in COVID-19. Then there are antibiotics, as you responded, doxycycline and some other. Then supportive care such as supplement, zinc, vitamin C. Great. So there is a good understanding as of now, so I need not to go into the basic, we will move now from there. So yeah, that's all I wanted to know from you guys. So thank you for that. Now, with the background of COVID-19, it spread, positive agent, risk factors. Now, let's have a look at what are the management options. The medication. So we are focusing on medication because it's the pharmacy crowd and we don't have vaccine as of now, but there are a number of vaccine trials ongoing and human studies have started, so that's the good news. So looking into the pharmacotherapy, it's symptomatic, as I said, so there is no mainstay of management. All the current medications that are being trialed in COVID-19 are symptomatic treatment only. So the first group is called as repurpose medication. What do we mean by repurpose medication? So repurpose medication means these medications have been used in clinical practice for managing other disease conditions, and now they are being trialed for their efficacy in COVID-19. That's why we have repurposing their use for this new condition, the new pandemic. So the most common one that is being trialed in clinical practice are antivirals. So the antivirals are the most common one, repurposed medication. So which are the antivirals? The conventional one which are currently being used in the management of HIV infection, such as ritonavir. So ritonavir or other antiretroviral therapies are currently being used in moderate to severe cases of COVID-19, that means those 20% of cases who are being hospitalized. 5-aminophenolates. What are 5-aminophenolates? This is the pharmacological class of chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine. Okay, so our conventional antimalarials. Okay, antimalarials and drugs in the management of rheumatoid arthritis. So chloroquine and more popular hydroxychloroquine are also being trialed. Okay, so when I use the word trial, it's on experimental basis. Still not the mainstay of management. So at present, there is no specific pharmacotherapy which is approved by any regulatory body, which include US FDA, Food and Drug Administration, or UK Medicine and Healthcare Product Regulatory Agency, called as MHRA, or in Australia, we have Therapeutic Good Administration, or TGA. None of the regulatory body has approved that, okay, this is the mainstay of management. Indian Council of Medical Research, or ICMR, okay, that is currently overseeing the, all the potential therapies in COVID-19 have indicated potential role of chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, which I will get to shortly. So in repurposed medication, antivirals, that is antiretroviral in particular, ritonavir, and 5-aminoquinoline, that is chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, are commonly being given to moderate to severe cases of hospitalized COVID-19 patients. Now, when the patients are administered these therapies, antiviral and antimalarial, they may also be given what we call as supportive therapies or adjunct therapies so as to prevent any secondary infection happening. For that, antimicrobials, antibiotics could be given so that patients should not develop a super infection or a secondary infection after catching COVID-19. To prevent that, antimicrobials could be given, such as penicillins, doxycyclines, cephalosporins, chloroquinolones, aminoglycoside antibiotics. Corticosteroids are also being given on a case-by-case basis. Especially, let's say if the patient has asthma, okay, or the patient has COPD, already a known case, so they may be on corticosteroid to manage their respiratory condition. So the current guideline says that do not stop corticosteroid, continue corticosteroid if they are taking it as an inhaler. And also to prevent some of the complex or severe infection, corticosteroid are also being trialed in selective cases. So are the biological agents. Which are the biological agents? Your monoclonal antibodies, okay, given as injectables, such as tocilizumab. Okay, so tocilizumab is one of the biological agent currently being trialed with good results, but it is supportive care only as and when needed in selective patient. So that's the second group of medication. The last group are experimental therapy. That means they are novel drugs, okay, which are not commonly trialed in previous epidemic. Of course, these drugs were used for Ebola infection. So for example, as most of you have responded, remdesivir is an antiviral which has been trialed in Ebola infection in the past with little success, was not very promising. Now there are a number of clinical trials which are showing efficacy in severe cases of COVID-19, especially in regard to it is reducing the duration of hospitalization. So let's say if the patient is hospitalized for 2 weeks, good trials have shown that remdesivir can reduce the duration to 10 days. Okay, but still, we need larger scale randomized controlled trial to prove this hypothesis. That's why they come under experimental therapy category. Both are antivirals, remdesivir and favipiravir. So these are the three major drug classes in the management of COVID-19. Repurposed medication, conventional antiviral, that is used in the management of HIV or AIDS, then conventional antimalarial such as hydroxychloroquine, then you have supportive care, which could be as and when required, case by case basis, antibiotic, corticosteroid, biological agents, and then you have experimental therapies. Experimental therapies are usually tried in severe cases, okay, moderate to severe cases where the rate of mortality prediction could be very high. In those cases, they may go with experimental therapy. Now, supplements. Okay, so supplements are usually given, but they are not of any proven benefit as of now, which may include vitamin C supplement, zinc supplement, okay, and so on. But we don't have good quality studies to prove their efficacy as of now. So where these experimental therapies and where are these drugs classified and how the finding is happening in current pandemic, especially in regard to, let's say, lockdown, labs are closed, clinical trials cannot happen widely, okay, across the globe. So let's have a look at what's been happening around the world. So how is research happening in times of pandemic, especially in times of lockdown, in times where chemistry labs, preclinical labs, clinical trial centers are shut down, till we have been able to come up with number of therapeutic options, number of measures that have helped to a certain extent in reducing the mortality of this pandemic. So there is an understandable urgency for evidence-based data collection and sharing during this current crisis. And the work which is conducted by the practitioners and the researchers across the globe is definitely commendable. But the pressure to provide promising results in the race to achieve recognition of who will be the first to come with the cure should not compromise on quality of evidence. That is what is happening, and that is what the crux, the core of this webinar is. Lot of publication bias. What do you mean by publication bias? Only positive findings are published. Negative findings are hidden or not shared on publicly accessible platform. What could be the negative findings? Negative findings could be, for example, drug-induced abnormal heart rhythm, drug-induced myocardial infarction or heart attack, drug-induced acute respiratory distress syndrome, or drug-induced pneumonia. Now, these are severe adverse events. It could lead to increase in mortality as well as morbidity, especially in patients with COVID-19 who are already immunocompromised. Publication bias is so common in current COVID-19 literature. Why it is happening? Another reason is poor study methods. The clinical studies that are being conducted and published are usually poor in design. So while promising signals have been found, promising signal in regard to remdesivir could be effective, ritonavir could be effective, corticosteroid may help. So these all are signals. Okay, so they are alerting that look, there is a possibility that these are the likely promising candidate. But these signals must be interpreted with caution. Why? Because of high risk of bias in this study design. Now, without protecting from this risk of bias and the confounding through poor study method, we risk exposing our COVID-19 patient to a treatment where the potential for benefit is unclear, yet the potential for harm from adverse effect is very high. That's what is a highly likely possibility in current context. And that's why when I shared you the pharmacotherapy slide, the current data do not support the use of any pharmacotherapy outside the context of a clinical trial or emergency care or compassionate access based on the guideline or the public health advisory of that particular country. So, for example, in India, Indian Council of Medical Research just today have released an advisory that they are going to revise the treatment recommendation. So it will be interesting to see what are the current treatment recommendation listed by ICMR. And it looks like remdesivir, which is an experimental therapy, is most likely to be included for severe cases of COVID-19. What is the medical information status in COVID-19 era? So as I said, commendable that a lot of research is being done and it's ongoing. So the COVID-19 literature, which is published since January, has reached more than 30,000 medical papers in the last 4 months. That means the amount of medical information in form of clinical trials, observational studies, case reports are doubling every 20 days. This is among the biggest explosion of scientific literature ever. Now, given that volume, another example is the National Library of Medicine Registry. I'm sure you must be familiar with clinicaltrials.gov website. So that's a global website where all the clinical trials need to be registered. So at present, there are close to 3,000 clinical trials focused on drugs only. This is a huge number. We haven't seen something like this over the past few decades in evidence-based medicine. So this all is good news, right? Because it looks like a lot of people are doing research. The amount of information is doubling every 20 days, which is the biggest explosion ever. So what are the problems? what are the challenges? Let's have some look here. Deluge of poor quality research is sabotaging evidence-based response. Now, before the pandemic, it was estimated that around 85% of research, medical research, is wasted because of poor questions in designing the research, then poor study design. So let's say if there is a clinical trial of remdesivir, there is no comparator with whom you should compare. So whenever a clinical trial happens, you need to have a meaningful comparator so that you can determine efficacy and safety. If the comparator is just a placebo, not a gold standard antiviral, then the finding may differ. Okay, so lack of control, poor study design, method of randomization is inadequate, then non or poor reporting of results. So sharing only the positive finding of remdesivir, not sharing what are the adverse effects of remdesivir, which again are severe in nature. Okay, so that all need to be put into context. Now, most of these problems are amplified in COVID-19 research. Why? Because there is time pressure and there is inadequate research infrastructure which is contributing. The medical research is responding to the COVID pandemic at breathtaking speed, which is highly commendable. There has been a maelstrom of global research with mixed consequences. What are the positives? So the positives are greater provision of open access medical information pertaining to COVID-19. What do you mean by open access? Anybody can read it. Okay, a lay public can open Google and can search the paper and they can access full text of the paper. COVID-19 has increased research collaboration across the globe. It has increased governance and ethics approval. So there is fast track ethics approval, governance approval. For example, let's say fast track approval of vaccine to start phase one study among healthy volunteers and then it moving subsequently into patients to phase two. Very fast track. Same is the case with pharmacotherapy. Classical example, remdesivir. Remdesivir has got a fast track approval now to be tried and tested in phase 3. Okay. That is, patients suffering from COVID-19 would undergo trial of remdesivir through clinical trial participation and emergency access. So there are a number of positives that has happened because of the COVID-19 era. But on the other hand, many problems have become evident as we just discussed. MedRxiv, so this is the abbreviation MedRxiv, but it is pronounced as MedRxiv. It is a preprint server for health sciences, especially in context to COVID-19. This is a preprint platform where all the studies are available online before they are published in a scientific journal. Okay, so they are usually in the raw form. Now, posting in this platform have increased over 400%. Over the last 4 months. This is substantial. And the views and downloads have increased 100-fold. But the caution is preprint accuracy of information, which is given here, is questionable, especially in regard to total number of patients who are enrolled in the study. What are the key results? What are the key outcomes are missing? So if we are taking information from this preprint service such as MedRxiv and using it for our patient, it may lead to a huge safety issue. Let's have a look at another example. Okay, so that's what we were discussing so far on COVID-19 information explosion. There is too much available to digest as of now. We don't have time as well. So people don't have time to read through entire article and figure out what is the value added by this paper. And the bottom line, what are the limitations of this paper? Okay, we need to know that as a future healthcare practitioner, as a pharmacy student, as an allied health student, you definitely need to know what this paper add. And the bottom line, what are the limitations of this paper and how it apply to your context, which I will shortly share. Let's take an example of the volume of medical literature in COVID-19. So if I compile all the papers of COVID-19 medical literature over the past 4 months, medical, non-medical literature, this is the height. of this COVID-19 medical literature. And if I compare it with a residential resort in Gold Coast where I live, so that's Q1 Gold Coast building. So the height of COVID-19 medical literature will easily surpass one of the tallest residential building of the world. That's how is the medical information explosion just in the last 4 months. So what's happening? Healthcare practitioners, researchers, students, we don't have time to go through everything, right? So we need tool that helps us critique this in less time. If we don't know the tool, it will lead to a term what is called as satisficing. So if you can quickly read this, satisficing is when practitioners tend to be satisfied with information that they can readily access, while often sacrificing quality for convenience when providing drug information. Satisficing is a big no in evidence-based medicine because it's proven that it may harm the patients. It may lead to inadequate patient care, irrational medication usage. So is keeping up-to-date mission impossible? Okay, with this information explosion, can we cope up with ever-increasing information? Can we differentiate between real and rubbish evidence? So looks like it's almost mission impossible. Let's take an example of another of our favorite drug, which everyone is talking about these days. Okay, that has led us to the paradigm of, is evidence-based medicine changing into hype-based medicine? Are we focusing on quantity and sensationalization of the news over quality? So when Donald Trump, president, said that he had a good feeling about hydroxychloroquine in the treatment of COVID-19, scientific fraternity has a bad feeling. In the midst of a pandemic, we are in a period of instability. The situation is dramatic and understandably frightening. Emotions are high and no one is safe. So because we are in the middle of a pandemic, the argument goes that we cannot wait for trials. We feel compelled to do something. We cannot allow people to die before randomized controlled trials are reported. We are urged to act. That's where a number of politicians are acting, to do something, to show something, compromising on the ethos of evidence-based medicine. What's the story of hydroxychloroquine? Very interesting. A conventional anti-malarial, tried and tested, number of conditions, especially in malaria and rheumatoid arthritis, and being shown to have some efficacy in COVID-19. But then it was sensationalized to such an extent that it was projected as the next big thing, as a cure for COVID-19, which is far from it. Number of studies were being published, which were not sponsored by commercial interest or pharmaceutical industries, and those studies were critiqued by evidence-based practitioners such as me and our team and other practitioners around the world, looking into what is the benefit and risk profile of hydroxychloroquine. Definitely it's efficacious in COVID-19, but it is reserved for moderate to severe cases, and also it is reserved for patients who do not have some key comorbid condition. That means the patient should not be a known case of heart or cardiac problem. So they should not have a abnormal cardiovascular complication as a comorbid. Majority of the patient of COVID-19 progressing to moderate to severe cases may have one or two comorbid. Cardiovascular is very common. So hydroxychloroquine is a no-go zone there. Why? Because it is proven through number of clinical studies in the past that hydroxychloroquine could cause QT prolongation. That means it may cause irregular heartbeat. It is a pro-arrhythmic drug. Okay, so chances of arrhythmia progressing then to cardiovascular complications such as myocardial infarction, heart attack, is very high with hydroxychloroquine. So we can't just use it in the management of COVID-19 like paracetamol. So there's a huge difference between using a paracetamol and using a hydroxychloroquine tablet. It needs to be used in the context of, again, a clinical trial, emergency access, compassionate access under physician supervision. There are guidelines of few countries which recommended prophylactic use also for high-risk group, the frontline healthcare practitioner. but still there are a number of studies that are ongoing. Now, interestingly, just 2 weeks back, one of the biggest cohort study, an observational study, that means they collected the safety data of hydroxychloroquine across all the clinical trial centers around the world. Around 20 to 30 centers data were collected and it was published in Lancet, okay, one of the most prestigious medical journal. And the finding from this study was that hydroxychloroquine can cause increased in intensity or rate of cardiovascular complication and should not be prescribed in patient that has abnormal cardiovascular history. So that was the key finding. Apart from cardiovascular complication, there were a number of adverse drug reactions reported with hydroxychloroquine. Interestingly, what happened last week or 10 days back, the authors of this paper requested Lancet to please withdraw this paper from the publication platform because we cannot trust the safety data that is being reported. So Lancet then retracted this paper, and this paper was withdrawn from public platform altogether. As I said, Lancet is one of the oldest and most respected medical journal in the world, and they published this article on COVID patient receiving hydroxychloroquine that may develop increased heartbeat irregularity and decrease hospital survival rates. The result from that paper was treated as authoritative, and major drug trials were immediately stopped because there is this paper from 30 plus clinical trial center across the world saying hydroxychloroquine is not safe. Obviously then World Health Organization and other regulatory bodies were alarmed. So what they did, they immediately stopped the ongoing hydroxychloroquine clinical trial in the management of COVID-19, because why treat anyone with an unsafe drug, right? And then this thing happened where the Lancet study was retracted, withdrawn from the literature entirely at the request of 3 of its authors who conducted this study. And what they said, they can no longer vouch for the authenticity of the primary data that says that it is unsafe. Now, given the seriousness of the topic and the consequence of the paper, this is one of the most consequential withdrawal in modern history of any big safety paper. The consequences are extreme, and the consequences could be for any of us on discovering, let's say, a patient who has persistent cough and respiratory difficulty are directly determined by outcome from research like this. So papers like today's retraction by Lancet determine how people will live or die tomorrow. They affect what drugs are recommended, what treatment are available, and how we get them sooner. So what was the issue here? The issue, it goes back to, again, what are the major limitations that's been happening in evidence-based medicine. So when this paper was accepted by Lancet, it was very important by independent experts to go through the data presented by the authors. The authors should have presented all the raw data, primary data, which was missed in this case because of time pressure, because of enthusiasm to publish and share the finding. So peer review is what I was saying. So peer review during time of pandemic faces a brutal dilemma. The moral importance of releasing important information with global consequences quickly versus the scientific importance of evaluating the presented work fully, which unfortunately didn't happen here, leading to withdrawal of this paper from the journal altogether. So fortunately now the trials have restarted by the global organizations, now that the authors do not take responsibility of the safety data, and they say that the safety data could be questionable. Hydroxychloroquine looks like a safer option. So as of now, the trials have restarted on hydroxychloroquine, but this was a very interesting case study, especially in the event of pandemics, on how one of the best medical journal like Lancet could also make mistake. Besides COVID-19, number of waste have had happen in medical research, and I am just giving you a screenshot of some of them. oseltamivir, which is used in management of Tamiflu in pandemic influenza. So there were a number of biased information where 60% of the patient data were not reported. Fully study reports were not accessible. Rosiglitazone in the management of diabetes, gabapentin in the management of neuralgia, paroxetine an antidepressant where paroxetine was heavily promoted in clinical depression among teenagers, and the adverse effect of it, which was observed during post-marketing surveillance, was suicide tendency among teenagers were on high with paroxetine. Okay, so there are a number of drug disasters that have happened in the past because of poor study quality, the way the research were conducted. The way research are also presented in scientific literature is also questionable. Let's say if you go through a scientific paper in a scientific journal, in abstract section, a randomized controlled trial may have a missing effect size. That means, let's say currently there are more than 85 hydroxychloroquine trials happening around the world, randomized controlled trial. The sample size is very important. Okay, ideally there should be more than 100 patients being trialed to see any effect and can extrapolate it to public. If the sample size calculation is not adequate, research finding could be questionable. That's where poor quality papers comes under scrutiny once they are being used in a wider public platform or domain. So what's the way ahead? What you could do? Okay, because you all are from healthcare background, you all have the responsibility to inform, okay, to inform different stakeholders. That may include other healthcare practitioners, patient, their carer, and policymakers, because you never know where you will land up in your career in future, maybe in pharmaceutical industry, maybe in pharmacy, that may be community and hospital pharmacy, in clinical trial, in drug safety, in medical affairs, or in management, okay, and so on and so forth. So it's very important for us to know what's the way ahead. And this pandemic has definitely taught us a big lesson not to take evidence-based medicine for granted and how it can have a direct impact on our patient. So let's have some of the tools. I think I'll quickly show you some of the basics because it's very important to go back to basics and then take it from there and put it into the context of current pandemic. Making sense of health information. So how I can make informed health choices. It's very important for you as a pharmacy student and allied health student. So knowing which health information to trust and which to ignore can be hard. So you might get conflicting information from many people who claim to have the answers. So while this current dilemma has provided that challenge, but take that challenge as an opportunity. So how can I make informed health choices? I've just given you an example here of the picture that you see is from Cochrane. So Cochrane is a not-for-profit organization and one of the most trustworthy resources that you can rely on, especially in regard to an unbiased evidence-based medicine information in context to COVID-19. It's freely available online, so I'll definitely encourage you to go through the Cochrane website. Just Google, how can I make informed health choices, Cochrane, and you will go through that website. They have a free course that anyone can participate on EBM in context to COVID-19, and there are a lot of key points that's given there. It may take hardly half an hour to finish that online course, but you will come up with a lot of take-home messages out of it that you can then share to others. Where can I find information that I trust? So in this ever-changing situation that we are in, it's important to have the latest information, but we must make sure that it comes from trustworthy sources. So what are the trustworthy sources? As I said, one is Cochrane. Then another one, others will be guidelines, clinical guidelines. So you can go through ICMR website, Indian Council of Medical Research in India. But I would strongly encourage you to go through global regulatory and guidelines websites, such as one is from NIH, National Institute of Health, excellent source on COVID-19 management. Okay, they have nicely differentiated between what are the benefits, what are the risks, and what are the groups that this therapy could be given. So National Institute of Health COVID-19 guidelines, you can Google that. Another one is Infectious Disease Society of America, IDSA. So they have also summarized COVID-19 management. So NIH, IDSA, Therapeutic Good Administration Australia, TGA. You can Google that and put COVID-19. List of therapeutic recommendations are being given in regard to their benefit and harm. Another important point is, how shall I communicate finding to lay public? Very important for you, okay, to minimize the hype, the hysteria, as well as WhatsApp forwards, okay, because you are healthcare practitioners of the future. So it's very important for you to balance the information and put it in context of evidence-based medicine. So let's have a look at some of the key tools that you can incorporate and use it in your day-to-day activity, especially in context to current pandemic. So I'm going back to basic now. I'll quickly cover this. Be familiar with what are the 5 A's in evidence-based medicines. This is a basic formula. The very basic of evidence-based practice is knowing what are the 5 A's. So the important thing here is, as I said, before the pandemic, it was estimated that up to 85% of research is wasted. That's a huge number. And in COVID-19 context, around 95% of the research is waste. And we can easily prevent that. Okay, so when I say waste, it has a significant impact, not only in harming the patient, but also on our economy, okay, on our psychosocial dynamics, and in the future generation. So practicing 5 A's is very important. First is A, stand for ask a question. It's very important to ask correct question so that we determine what is the best study design to answer that. So let's say if a question is hydroxychloroquine effective in the management of severe COVID-19 cases? So once you ask the question, then you access the evidence. So access the evidence means, once you ask the question, is hydroxychloroquine effective? It is a therapy-based question. You as a student should know which is a best study design to answer a therapy-based question, and the best study design to answer whether a drug is effective or whether a drug is safe is always a randomized controlled trial, RCT, is the best study design to answer that. That's why if you are asking a wrong question and if you are looking at a wrong study type, it may lead to a wrong information communicated to the stakeholder who could be your patient, where harm could be done. Okay, so very important, ask correct question, select the best study type for that. For us as pharmacy background or allied health background, for therapy-based question looking into efficacy, the correct study design, the best study design has to come from a randomized controlled trial. That means hydroxychloroquine needs to be tested against a gold standard, a best treatment available. If the treatment is not a gold standard or not available, then it has to be compared with what is the usual care given. There should be a comparator group. Okay, both the groups then should be independently observed for a specific duration of time that mimics the progression of COVID-19. It should not be for only 2 days or 3 days. It should be for up to 2 weeks then. And then the outcome should be assessed independently by researchers that do not have any commercial interest in hydroxychloroquine. Okay, so ask the question, access the evidence. Once you access the evidence, let's say you have picked a randomized controlled trial of hydroxychloroquine. Third and the most important part in EBM is to appraise the evidence. What do you mean by appraise the evidence? You will be a critique to judge the quality of that evidence. I'm sure you're familiar with the role of critics. Okay, so for example, for movies, they give 2-star, 3-star, 4-star to the movies. Same as pharmacy or allied health students, you are critique when you are practicing EBM. Okay, so how you do it? There are a number of tools available that I'll shortly share to critique a paper in regard to how good or bad was the paper. Okay, once you have critiqued and assessed the quality, then you apply that information to your stakeholders. So apply means you can inform it to your doctor, to other specialist, or to a patient, or to a relative, or to a carer of the patient. Okay. Last is audit. Audit means self-reflection on how you have done this entire session, where you went wrong, what are your strengths, what are your weakness, how you can work on your weakness. These five steps are lifelong learning skills in evidence-based medicine, equally applicable in any healthcare scenario, okay, to any healthcare discipline. So these are the evidence pyramid, looking into which is the best study design sources and the least one. So if you can see, the bottom ones are observational studies, non-clinical trials, and as we go up the ladder, clinical trials, meta-analysis, systematic reviews, especially if it is published by Cochrane, are considered one of the best, okay, or gold standard. Another at the bottom of the pyramid in evidence level is opinion. So let's say if someone is saying that hydroxychloroquine is effective based on their experience only, that has the least level in evidence-based practice, because opinion will vary from one person to another. That's why the recommendation has to come from higher quality sources, such as a clinical trial, such as guidelines, such as systematic reviews. Search smart. When you are providing information of, let's say, about COVID-19 to any stakeholder, look for authentic sources of information, such as PubMed, Embase, Cochrane database of systematic reviews. If you don't have time to go through that, there are pre-appraised sources who act as critics, and they give us a digestible form of information. So let's say a clinical trial of hydroxychloroquine is published in 35 pages. You don't have time. So you can go through then some of the pre-appraised, pre-digested sources of evidence, such as BMJ clinical evidence. You can check it online, up to date. I'll strongly recommend go through up to date, one of the best sources in regard to efficacy, safety, and implication of therapies. Essential Evidence Plus, then Dynamed Plus. But for you as student, I will strongly recommend go through UpToDate, go through BMJ Clinical Evidence and Cochrane Collaboration. At least three you should be familiar, regardless of your specialty, your background. As long as you are healthcare science student, you should be familiar with these pre-digested sources of evidence. PubMed clinical query is also very handy in current context, because it gives you information on, for example, let's say if you want to read about COVID-19, its pathophysiology, on how it happens, what are the signs and symptoms, what are the management, these all are evidence-backed information in PubMed clinical queries. These are the quality criteria that you should check for in a paper. When I say you act as a critic, there are tools given to you to act as a critic and to rate. So for example, a published randomized controlled trial should be developed in accordance to, for example, this is one of the tool callers, CONSORT or CONSORT guidelines. So a randomized controlled trial should be conducted according to this protocol given by CONSORT. Let's say if it's not a randomized controlled trial, it's just an observational study. So we have number of guidelines. I'm just listing one, Moose guideline. If someone is doing a systematic review of hydroxychloroquine, so let's say there are 35 clinical trials, reviewers will develop a paper that summarizes finding from 35 papers into one in the form of a systematic review. So a systematic review should be developed according to PRISMA guideline. And then let's say there are clinical guidelines. So let's say a guideline is given by Indian Council of Medical Research on management of COVID-19. So those guidelines should also have a method on how the guidelines are developed. Okay, a best quality clinical guideline may follow AGRI protocol. So CONSORT, Moose, PRISMA, AGRI, what are these? These are quality control standards based on which respective study design should be conducted. So when a paper is published, they should declare which quality control standard they have used to conduct their research. Okay, they need to specify. They can't just bluff. that we have used Prisma for systematic review, and when you read, it was hardly in alignment with that quality assurance tool. Okay, so that will trigger alarm. That will put credibility at stake for those authors. So they won't usually falsify that. Okay, so make sure when you're going through a study that that study is being conducted through quality control standards such as these ones. Okay, some more. What are the way ahead in current context in medical information explosion, and how frontline workers are dealing with ever increasing medical information and the hype associated with it? So this figure gives a summary on avoidable waste or inefficiency in biomedical research. So let's say if a research is conducted, it's very important for us to know our research decision based on questions relevant to users of research. That means a clinical study should be designed keeping in mind a patient who has developed COVID-19. What are the patient-oriented outcomes that matter? So here is a drug, hydroxychloroquine. And what are the endpoints of in COVID-19 by using hydroxychloroquine? So some will say reduction in viral load could be an endpoint. All the drugs that we just discussed, repurposed, adjunct, and experimental, are showing that they may reduce the viral load. But whether reducing the viral load is related to reducing the clinical symptoms in patients is questionable. That's why it's very important that there should be two different clinical endpoints. One related to the lab data, such as reduction in viral load, reduction in blood pressure, reduction in blood glucose. Okay, so that all are called as surrogate markers. So that should be one endpoint, of course. But the another endpoint is even more important. That means, does it matter to the patient? Which include, there is patient is able to breathe normally. Should be one clinical endpoint. The patient heart rate is normal, another endpoint. Patient is able to go back to work. The patient is able to function independently. So all these are patient-oriented outcome that matters. A clinical study should have both lab outcome, clinical outcome. What is happening in COVID-19 research? 90% of the study are just reporting lab outcomes. We don't know, does it really matter at the end? Is there a direct correlation between reduction in viral load and the patient feeling better and is not infectious anymore? Okay, so that's why clinical and surrogate endpoint should go hand in hand. That was the first thing that we discussed here. Then appropriate research design method and analysis. As I said, if it is a therapy-based question in research, whether hydroxychloroquine is effective or safe, whether remdesivir is effective or safe, which is a best study design, a randomized controlled trial, there is no two thoughts about it. An observational study or a case report will not help here. We have to depend on a large scale randomized controlled trial of preferably more than 100 patients from each study site. Okay, a multicentric trial. That's where we will get to know a bigger picture, a real life scenario of what's happening with this drug. There's some more accessible research information. Okay, so more than 50% of the studies are never fully reported. Okay, so okay, we hear the study is claiming that hydroxychloroquine or remdesivir is highly effective. It's all good, but where is the safety data? Make sure you go through the secondary outcome. If the primary outcome is efficacy, the secondary outcome of that paper has to be safety, so that we need to know, okay, COVID-19 is being managed, but is it coming with the cost of a patient developing heart attack? Okay, the patient developing arrhythmia, the patient developing breathlessness or asthma. We need to know that. Whether therapy is causing it, we need to know. At present, unfortunately, more than 80% of the clinical research studies on COVID-19 are not reporting or not fully reporting the adverse outcome. It is done in a very irregular, haphazard manner. Some good news, okay, some positives. Okay, so when there is a global rush to research a disease, a centralized accessible portal, ideally hosted by a regulatory body, a global regular organization, is preferable. So perhaps most notably, there are at least three clinical trial groups being conducted around the world. India is also a member, so is Australia. So one is recovery trial, which is randomized evaluation of COVID-19 therapy. It's a multicentric, multinational trial running parallel for all the major therapies that we just discussed on COVID-19 in a randomized double-blind manner, which is great. So the finding from this will be very encouraging and helpful to inform therapeutic decision in COVID-19. So are other collaborations such as the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness and Innovation. So this one, as you can see in the picture, is looking into vaccine development, and they are collecting data of all the vaccine trials around the world. So recovery is one. Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness and Innovation is another. Principle that is platform randomized trial of intervention against COVID-19 in elderly population, because they are at very high risk, is another global clinical trial that is happening. But having said that, the global multinational clinical research is far and few as of now. We need more organization to come forward and conduct a high quality study design to answer most of the inconclusive information in this current pandemic. What we are doing in Australia. So in Australia, along with therapeutic good administration, now I'm discussing this in regard to evidence-based medicine. So we have a national COVID-19 clinical evidence task force, and we are working closely with Cochrane, as I shared, which is a not-for-profit organization. So it's predominantly run by a non-for-profit organization, which is Cochrane Group. So we are developing real-time, synthesizing real-time evidence from published literature. So that is, we are conducting reviews, and we are recommending this in regard to what are the first line, second line, third line options in COVID-19. So I am one of the member of this National COVID-19 Clinical Evidence Task Force, and my job is to critique and synthesize evidence in regard to COVID-19. All right, so we are almost now at the final phase of this webinar, and before I finish, we'll have a question and answer discussion, because I think there are 10 or 15 minutes remaining. So we'll definitely have question and answer and career development opportunities. But before we finish the core topic, two take home message: we must ensure that we continue to investigate the uncertainty of COVID-19, review the totality of research to ensure we are not missing important data, register and report trial, and press for better but not necessarily more research. Okay, very important. Pandemics may feel frightening, but even more frightening is annexing or dismissing the scientific method in dealing with it. That's one take home message. If you haven't understood anything from this webinar, please, these two are the take home message that you should think about. Okay, whenever you are providing any information on COVID-19 to any stakeholders. Okay, let's do a quick activity now. We have 15 minutes remaining. Okay, back to our mentee. What is the most challenging task for future evidence-based professionals? Yeah, so you can list. Okay, you can rate those stars. So if you can go back to your mentee.com and then attempt this one. I hope it's working, or let me know. Okay, so you can go back to mentee and enter the code, and it should be available. Let me know if not. Now I can see. Thank you for that. Okay, so the most challenging task for future evidence-based practitioners, students, faculty, researchers, policymakers, meeting global standards in research in practice, yeah, differentiating between real and rubbish evidence, to critique and generate evidence in real time, to dismiss WhatsApp university forwards, as we call them, and encourage evidence-informed approach, or understanding medical statistics and interpretation. Very important, you know. As a healthcare student, it's very important for us to understand the statistics, because that's how papers finding are being manipulated or published. If we don't know statistics, it will be very easy to fall trap to that. So understanding the science of statistics within healthcare language is so important for us. Okay, so mindful of the time. So what I'll do is I'll quickly share. Last question from you guys. Okay, ask us. Do you have any query? Can you please type if you want to know about higher studies, courses, scholarships, programs, anything in EBM, please type it out here. Please type your question here in the box. I'm sure there will be an option given to you in the box here that you can type.
Students, if you have any questions related to Dr. Khan's topic related to EBM and anything, you can just type out your questions, or you can just type out to unmute yourselves. We'll unmute you from here.
Sure. And I'll quickly share some of the programs that we have while you type it out. So that we utilize the time to the best of our capacity.
Okay, sir. Sumit Rana is having a question. How does genetics impact our understanding of COVID-19?
So, thanks for that question, Sumit. There are a number of genetic-based research which is ongoing in understanding, especially this is coming in regard to pathophysiology of COVID-19, which group is more exposed or more vulnerable, because the SARS-CoV-2 virus, or coronavirus as we call, enters our lungs, the bronchial tissue, with the help of angiotensin converting enzyme receptors, or we call as ACE receptors. So currently, antivirals and antimalarial prevents the binding of this virus to ACE receptor. Now, there is overexpression of ACE or angiotensin converting enzyme receptors in some population where there may be a genetic correlation. So there are studies ongoing on that. So yeah, thanks for that question.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Priyansh is having a question. Will COVID-19 mutate into a more dangerous virus?
Okay, interesting question, Priyansh. Thanks for that. The good news is, if you compare the virulence factor of the initial, when it was widespread in Italy, China, and then to Italy. So if you compare the virulence strain of Italy and Spain to what is happening right now in India, so the virulence factor has gone down significantly, and that's a big good positive news out of it. And even if you can see the recovery rate in India, it's more. For the first ever time, I think in the last 2 days, the recovery rate has gone up as compared to the newly detected case. So I think that is a promising sign.
Okay, all right. So Supriya Singh is asking, can stem cell beat COVID-19?
Okay, again, we can't say that with certainty. There are promising results of the stem cell and related therapies, but still, you need more large-scale randomized controlled trial to claim anything as of now. I can see this now on the screen through this. I'm just taking a shot. Courses after PharmD in Australia, scholarship program. higher studies master's program. Okay, I think most of it is related to higher education. So let's have a quick scroll through of studies that's on offer at Griffith. I'll brief about, let's say, those for PharmD students, as you are from pharmacy background, so as B-Pharm student, those who want to move into, let's say, clinical profession of practicing as a pharmacist overseas, we have international scholarships, especially for our M-Pharm program. And I've given a link there, griffith.edu, or you can just Google Griffith University M-Pharm. It should lead you to the page. It gives information on the fees and everything, so I'm not going into detail, but there are scholarships available for pharmacy students from, let's say, who have done PharmD, those who have done B-Pharm. The advantage of doing this program is it gives you a straight pathway towards registration as a practicing pharmacist in Western world. There are very few programs like this. I'm not going into detail on what's the pathway, because I'm sure you know, once you finish your PharmD or B-Pharm, then you have to go through series of pre-registration exam and screening, and it's a very lengthy process, especially stage one exam in Australia. For overseas pharmacy student, failure rate is very, very high. So you can get away with that by enrolling into Master of Pharmacy program after you have finished your PharmD or B-Pharm. So this is a 2 years program. And after completing 2 years, you do an internship, which is a paid internship for 1 year. Okay, after finishing the internship, you work as a practicing pharmacist, either in hospital as a clinical pharmacist, as a community pharmacist, or you can work in clinical trials, clinical research, or you can move further and do your PhD as well. The picture that I shared here on the screen is of our M-Pharm student who has recently completed her M-Pharm and got her job offer in a clinical hospital here in Gold Coast, which is one of the biggest public hospitals in Queensland. She's from India. She did her B-Pharm, Bachelor of Pharmacy from Manipal Academy of Higher Education, and she got the Griffith Remarkable Scholarship. So she is one of our scholarship recipients. So there are a number of scholarship options available. Go through the webpage, and if you have any queries, send me an email. I will shortly share an email. So that's about M-Pharm. We have scholarship for PhD program as well. So again, you can Google Griffith University PhD scholarship for international student. Now, basically now, these scholarships are highly competitive because it covers everything, your tuition fee, as well as it gives living allowance as well. So you have to find a supervisor who can take you as a student, and there are a number of criteria that I'm happy to share. Okay, I can send it to Harleen, Madam, or Dr. Suman, who can then share it with you on what are the criteria. What I can say right now is, we look for M-Pharm candidates who have finished their M-Pharm and who have published. That should be at least one or two papers in a Q1, Q2, Q3 rank journal. Q1, Q2, Q3 rank journal. That's our basic criteria. So you should have a paper published, have done an M-Pharm with a similar thesis that matches with the expertise of your potential supervisors, who could be one of us. Okay, so more information I'll share with Dr. Suman and Helena.
Sir, we have one or two questions more. I guess these are myths, these questions, what they're asking, these are myths. I'll just share out the questions with you. Is it true, Isha Gautam is asking, is it true O blood group is less affected by COVID-19 virus?
No, I think that's a myth. There are a lot of myths. So blood group and its relation with in etiopathogenesis of COVID-19, there is no clear proven pathway in that. Almost all the blood groups are equally susceptible or at risk, depending on their comorbid history, age, and other risk factor.
Okay, sir. Shivali Verma has asked a question, sir, that she is an M-Pharm student in clinical research stream and she wants to further pursue in PhD. What are the possible options, scholarship and program?
So as I said, I will share the detailed information, but what I can suggest to you, what's the name of the student?
Shivali Verma, Shivali.
What I can suggest you, Shivani, is you can share your top five research area of interest, then send one page brief on what you did as your thesis in MPharm. Research output is what you are looking for. If you have a paper published or if you are planning to publish a paper, let us know. Okay, so that all information we want to know, because the most important thing is finding a supervisor who can take you as a PhD student. That's very important, one of the hardest part, because we get a lot of email from potential student around the world on a daily basis. So most of the supervisor then don't bother to check them. Okay, so I can guide you. Now that I know you are coming from Chittara, so I can guide you in regard to okay how exactly you should go about.
Okay, sir. One last question from Sumit Rana again. He wants to know the role of corticosteroids in the treatment of COVID-19.
Okay, so the role of corticosteroid is adjunct, as I said, supportive care, especially in regard to, let's say, a patient progressing into more severe case like sepsis, development of sepsis or septicemia. In that case, corticosteroid could be given on a case-by-case basis, or if the patient has already having a respiratory tract infection and is using corticosteroid, then it should be continued. It should not be stopped. So that's what is the role as of now of corticosteroid, especially in context to severe inflammation happening.
Okay, sir. We'll stop taking the questions as of now, as Dr. Khan will be joining us again on 15th, same time again.
Exactly, and I have put up my email, so if you have any query, feel free to send an email. I would also like to know your feedback about this webinar to students, so please let me know how you found this webinar, so that will help us to cater to the topic and content. When you are sending an email, please make sure that in the subject heading mention Chittara, Chittara University, so that I know where you are coming from.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
So on the closing note, again, I would like to say thank you, Dr. Khan. You know, it was such an informative session, and I believe the students have really enjoyed and they have really interacted, and it's good to see so many questions from the students as well. Simultaneously, I would also like to tell all the students that in reference to all your international queries, probably please call me on 9888-9880, or probably you can mark an email to me. You can take the email ID from Dr. Sumi, and I will be able to address your international travel queries when it comes to you with your master's or any other kind of semester exchange or PhDs abroad with Griffith University. So students can get in touch with them once they meet up the criteria, and then directly we will forward it to Dr. Sohail to take this forward. If that sounds perfect?
Yeah, that sounds perfect. And also, I think there are some like specific query, like can we do MD abroad after pursuing PharmD, or what is the scope of a student who completed PharmD from India in Australia for further study? So generic queries like this, I'm happy to address, but make sure you send an email through Harleen ma'am.
Any other questions? Attendees, any other questions?
I guess that's it.
I think we were all right on time, Harleen ma'am, or I hope I'm not gone beyond the limited time.
No, Dr. Khan, you are right on time. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you for reminding me.
Okay, sir.
Thank you for organizing this, and thank you to dear students. Okay, thank you for being so patient. I hope it was not too boring for you guys. But definitely send me an email. We would like to know your feedback on this webinar. Okay, and let's keep this discussion ongoing. And please, if one thing you can take from this webinar, do not forward any WhatsApp university messages. Do not convert evidence-based medicine to hype-based medicine.
Right, sir. Thank you for the session, sir. It was a very informative session, I guess, for all the attendees. So all the attendees, Dr. Khan will be again joining us on 15th. You will not receive an additional mail. You have to just click on the same mail which you have received for this session, and you can join for that session. And the time will be the same. It will be 10:30 a.m. Right? So I guess this concludes. Thank you, sir, for your time.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, everyone. Yeah.
We hope to see you again on 15th, sir.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, ma'am.
Thank you.
Bye, sir. Thank you. Madeline, ma'am, anything else?
Nothing, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you to all the students. And of course, thank you to you. And thank you to Dr. Khan. Thank you so much. And see you all on 15th at 10:30 a.m.